Hello and welcome to this event with Polar Bears International today. We are talking to women in Arctic science, and we are so excited to have you join us today to talk to our wonderful panel of incredible women that work on all different areas of the Arctic and have some really, really awesome research to talk to you about. We really want to hear your questions today. So please do take advantage of the Q&A box that you should see on your screen. We have moderators that are monitoring the questions. They'll answer some right in the chat box and then they'll send some to us. And I would love to give our panel as many of your questions as possible. We are also wondering where you're from. So we'll talk a bit about ourselves and where we're from, but we know already that people are watching from all over the world, which is so exciting. Already, we have folks joining us from Chile, California, Delaware, Dover, Michigan, Iowa, Indiana. That's incredible. And we are so happy about that. We're so happy to talk to you about what it's like working in the Arctic, which is a little bit different than most of those places. If you are just joining or you're from somewhere else, please do let us know. We would love to hear it and we'll give more shout outs later. And there will also be a moment partway through the chat today where we'll ask you to take a selfie if possible. So stay tuned for that. And make sure you have your teacher or parents' permission to do that before you post a selfie. So my name is Elise McCall, and I'm the Director of Conservation Outreach and a staff scientist at Polar Bears International. And I've been very lucky to do some of my Arctic research on polar bears, mostly in Hudson Bay, Canada. And I can talk a little bit about that later, but really I wanted to focus on our incredible panel today. And I would love to kick us off by having each panelist tell you a little bit about themselves and about their work and why it's so great, so you kind of have an idea of what everyone does. And then we will ask you to, again, please send in your questions and I'll be monitoring them the entire time. So I would really love to start with Tia. Tia, could you tell us a little bit about yourself and what kind of cool research you do in the Arctic?
Thank you, Elisa. So my name is Tia Beckshoft, and I am, like Elisa, I am a staff scientist with Polar Bears International. I'm joining you from Denmark today, but I have been lucky enough to see and to work with polar bears in various places in the Arctic. So in Greenland, I've seen them in Russia, in Svalbard, which is a part of Norway, and then a couple of different places in Canada. I've been doing polar bear research for about 16 years or so by now, with all sorts of different topics. A lot of it has been toxicology, so to do with pollution, and with monitoring bears and monitoring their health.
Thank you. Very exciting. I think that's such an interesting aspect of polar bear research. You see a lot of, like, we talk about Polar Bears International, the big movements and stuff, but I think the things that Tia does are so cool. So please do send her questions if you'd like. And I would love to pop over to Cassandra. Cassandra, could you tell us a little bit about what you do and why it's so cool?
Absolutely. Thanks, Elisa. Yeah, I'm Cassandra Debits, and I am a PhD candidate at the University of Manitoba in Winnipeg. And I'm about 800 kilometers south of Manitoba, where I've done a lot of polar bear research in the past with Polar Bears International, looking at non-invasive ways to measure their body condition through photographs. I've also had a chance to do some sea ice and seal work in Churchill as well. And currently most of my PhD research is looking at what seals eat. So we know polar bears like to eat seals, but we have a lot of question about what are the seals eating and how does that influence how much fat's on their body, which means how much fat polar bears are able to eat.
Fascinating research. Thank you so much, Cassandra. And I've been lucky enough to see a couple of talks from Cassandra over the last couple of years. And with our work on polar bears in Hudson Bay, her work is going to help so, so, so much kind of build up that broader picture of what's going on. Because when we do look at an ecosystem like the Arctic or any ecosystem in the world, you can absolutely focus on one animal and learn so much about one animal. But it's very, very important that you also take into consideration all the other animals that are part of the food web and a part of that ecosystem. And Casey also researches a different animal in that same ecosystem. So Casey, I'll pop it over to you to introduce yourself and your work.
Thanks, Elisa. Hi, everyone. I'm Casey Ryan. I'm also a PhD candidate at the University of Manitoba in Winnipeg. I'm from Chicago, though, so it's nice to hear that there's people from the States tuning in. I study, for my PhD research, I study an endangered population of beluga whales in Cumberland Sound, which is the east coast of Canada. And because they're an endangered population, we need to look at all sorts of things that might be affecting them. So I look at things like their dive behavior to see what kind of fish they might be eating. And from some of those photos, you can see we're also taking photos of them with a drone and from the boat, and we're building a photo ID catalog to try to identify the same whales over several years.
Thank you for that. And I think that is a fantastic use of technology to study animals. So when we are talking about Arctic science, you know, science is a big umbrella, but we also are really talking about engineering, technology, math, and also art. And we're going to talk a little bit about the art aspect of all this work a little bit later, too. So again, please, if you've got any questions for our panelists, send them in. If you can tell us where you're from, we'd love to know. I'm going to kick us off with our first question, which I think is maybe on the top of everyone's minds who's watching. And I'm going to throw it to everyone for a quick answer. How do you cope with the weather in the Arctic? I mean, I think for a lot of folks that aren't used to cold weather, it just seems brutal. So T, I'll start with you.
Well, that's a good question. You learn very quickly because otherwise you are in pain from the cold. So basically what I like to do is to have multiple layers. And I think probably the other guys here agree with me on that, multiple layers. So it's easy to adjust relative to whether you're sitting still or you're moving about. Yeah, and I have to say, like, good field equipment. I won't say you fall in love with it, but for sure it gets to be very close to your heart because it means so much to have that right clothing to keep you comfortable.
Could not agree more. Cassandra, anything to add?
I definitely agree with having good field gear or clothing. And I think a lot of field biologists, particularly ones that go into the Arctic, have that one fleece sweater that they wear all the time, that they always take. And as Taya mentioned, layering up is so important. And we basically do what polar bears have, how they've adapted to the Arctic, by having multiple different layers to keep us warm. And you definitely need a good fleece right close to your skin. And then you need a good shell to keep the snow off of you, the wind, breaking all the wind and all of that. So in the winter, it can get cold. The coldest I've experienced is minus 67 degrees Celsius when I went up to Nunavut in northern Canada in February. And even with my jacket and ski pants and multiple different layers, it takes the wind out of you when you go outside, for sure.
Yep, that sounds terrible, but I'm glad that you had the right equipment. And how about you, Casey? Do you have anything to add? How do you stay warm when you're working up north?
Well, I guess I consider myself lucky after hearing what Cassandra said. I've only been up in the summer, so it's not actually too bad. When I'm working up there, it's about 0 degrees Celsius. But yeah, I completely agree with the layer sentiment. I work on a boat, so we wear what's called a floater suit. It's basically this giant orange onesie that you wear in case you fall in, you will float and people can find you. So that also keeps you nice and warm. So, yeah.
So that's a very good point. The Arctic isn't completely freezing cold in all of it all year long. It absolutely still goes through seasons, much, much colder in the winter than it is in the summer, but generally still fairly chilly. And what you wear really is not a fashion statement in the north. It's all about safety. So we talk about our big parkas as safety equipment. They're not even just a coat. These are potentially going to save your life if something happens out when you're working, especially in the winter months there. So we did have a question about how polar bears stay warm in the Arctic. And Cassandra laid some nice groundwork there. But Tia, can I throw it back to you to maybe give a deeper explanation of how do polar bears and maybe some of these other Arctic animals, how are all these animals living in the Arctic when us humans need so much gear to even get by?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they have an inbuilt system, if you will. Of course, most of the year they have a nice layer of fat, of blubber, to keep their body insulated. But And that's mostly for staying warm in the water. Now, if like a polar bear, you're spending most of your time out of the water, it's important that you have really thick fur instead. And so polar bears and many other animals in the Arctic, and maybe even your dog at home, if you have like a husky, for example, will have two different kinds of hair. So what you're usually seeing when you're looking at a picture of a polar bear are what we call the guard hairs. They're about two thumbs long. They're very straight. They're quite wiry. And they're kind of like the windbreaker that the bear is wearing. And then underneath that, you have the woolen hair or the under fur, whatever you prefer to call it, which is kind of like one thumb long. And it's a lot softer. Yeah, a little bit curly, and it's like the nice sweater that you have on underneath your windbreaker. So together, those two kinds of hair, they really keep the polar bear warm and toasty in very cold temperatures.
That's very interesting to know. What about animals that live under the water? Casey, how do beluga whales handle these frigid, icy temperatures?
So their main adaptation is a thick layer of fat. So their blubber is extremely thick compared to, you know, more temperate or tropical marine mammals. I think it ranges from 10 to 15 centimeters, or about 5 inches for those in the States. And they also, if you look at the video, so they don't have a dorsal fin, right? That's something that we see on lots of dolphins and other whales. And we think that that dorsal fin is a way to get rid of heat in those animals, and belugas don't have one because they want to keep their heat.
So that's really interesting. We get a lot of questions about, you know, could we just move polar bears to some different part of the world? And really, polar bears are such an Arctic adapted animal between their fur, and they hunt seals and they rely on sea ice. Same with beluga whales. I don't know if people would know that so much about beluga whales, but could they live in warmer temperatures, or they're very much an Arctic whale species?
Yeah, I think that they are an Arctic whale species. There's not many cases of people trying to move them to warmer waters. I think it was last year or 2 years ago, there was a whale sighted off the coast of San Diego. And that was rare. It doesn't happen a lot. Because they have that thick layer of blubber, it would be hard for them to lose it, right? So they do need that cold water.
Very interesting. Okay, well, we're going to get back to some maybe bigger picture questions here. And please, again, keep sending them in. We have our great moderators passing them on. Let's start with this. How did you end up working in the Arctic in the first place? Was this always something you had on your mind? Was it an accident? Are you from the Arctic? And I'd love a brief note from all of you. So let's start with Cassandra on this one.
Okay, so for me, it was a little bit of a family introducing. My dad worked in the zoos here in Winnipeg and in places in the United States, and then actually had the opportunity to go and work in Churchill with Frontiers North Adventures. And when I was in high school, I got to go up to see what he was doing. And once you see a polar bear in the wild, you are instantly connected. And ever since that moment, I'd always enjoyed learning about animals, but when I went into university, I was very much focused on learning more about ecology and the Arctic system as a whole. And so that kind of led me to working with Polar Bears International, and then moving through different aspects of my university career, asking more and more questions about Arctic animals.
Thank you so much for that explanation. And then Kisi, you said you're originally from Chicago. So how did you end up working in Northern Canada?
It was a long road to get here. I definitely did not think that I would be doing Arctic research. Even, you know, 5 years ago, I wasn't sure that this was going to happen. I actually did my undergraduate degree in Hawaii. And so I kind of thought that I'd be studying tropical animals. But after my degree, I actually volunteered at the Shedd Aquarium for a few years, and they had both dolphins and belugas there. And ever since I was a kid, I've been obsessed with dolphins. I knew I wanted to be a marine biologist. I thought I would be working with dolphins. But actually at the aquarium, I really fell in love with the belugas. They're extremely intelligent. They all had different personalities. It was really interesting. So I kind of, yeah, switched directions, and in my master's I studied belugas and stuck with it with my PhD.
I love that story. I also started somewhere that was completely different. So I grew up in British Columbia in Canada, in Kamloops, which is in the interior and kind of a semi-arid, almost desert region. And I loved animals, wanted to work with them. But my first research projects were on deer mice in the wild. And I would trap them and put little collars on them and track them around the desert. A lot of rattlesnakes and black widows out there, very different than the Arctic. I also worked on toads for a summer. And then, yeah, just knowing someone who knew someone else led me to work on polar bears. And that's where I crossed paths with Tia when we were working on polar bears in out of University of Alberta in Edmonton. She was working on her postdoc and I was finishing up my master's. And so Tia, how did you end up where you are now?
Well, I think like everyone else, it's a lot of happy little coincidences mm-hmm. that lead to it. When I was first looking for a good master's project to dive into, I was actually contemplating going with ants instead. So, I mean, that would have led to a very different kind of career and fieldwork and everything. So, I mean, for me, it's been all about who I met when and what I was able to say yes to at various points in my life. Yeah.
Yeah, I love that. And I think that that's such a takeaway for anyone watching us today, no matter where you're joining us in the world right now. So whether you are from Chile or Delaware or Dover or Michigan or Iowa, if you want to end up in the Arctic, go for it. There's absolutely no reason you can't. Just like Tia said, you know, look for opportunities. There's a lot of, you know, who knows who things come up. And if you're willing to walk through some open doors and knock on a few closed doors, then you might find your way up north or anywhere else you'd like to work. And I think that's a really, really cool aspect of science and the way the world is now, the way we can all kind of connect and network virtually and kind of end up places we never might have thought. Casey, I think I have a specific question for you from Mrs. Olson's class. Have you ever fallen in the water?
Luckily, no. Okay. There have been a few close calls. Actually, one of our guides fell in. It was awful. Yeah, it's quite cold. But I've been lucky enough not to. Not yet, anyway.
So I assume your guide is okay and there was a mini rescue mission and they got to warm up.
Yeah, he was fine. He's from the area, so I think he didn't seem to mind as much as I would have. It was just his legs, luckily, but yeah, he recovered quickly.
That's great. So this is an interesting question from Marie, because I think the answer really varies depending on what you're working on and where. In fact, I know it incredibly varies. So where do you live while you're studying in the Arctic? So when we go up to work in these different areas, living conditions vary widely. It's like seasonally and geographically. So would everyone be able to just, again, give a quick blurb of like you maybe your most interesting living condition you've had in the Arctic and where it was? Because I know there are some really ridiculous stories out there, because in the Arctic, you kind of take what you can get. They don't have the infrastructure that, you know, more southern communities have, and you make the best with what you have. And it's usually totally fun and fantastic because you're with great people, but it can definitely be interesting. So maybe Cassandra, start with you. What's it like to live in some of these conditions?
Like you said, it can vary. And so I'm just trying to think of something that's unique. I know that there's usually field stations in some larger places where there's a lot of research, and these research stations have a little bit of your regular comforts from home. But when we go to further places that are more remote or not as frequently visited, they can be a little bit more rustic. I think what you're seeing now is the inside of a field station. But my most memorable, field experience was when I was in Svalbard, which is a northern archipelago of islands that belong to Norway. So it's about 70 degrees north on the latitude, and we actually had to sleep in tents when we were doing some sea ice research. But once you're inside the tent and you're blocked from the wind, you are surprisingly warm, even though there's still so much snow around you.
That's really interesting. And Tia, how about you?
So I think the quaintest place I've lived while I did field work was in this little wooden cabin on the north end of Banks Island. It was nice. It was cozy. It was warm. We did not have water or electricity or a lot of room or like a proper bathroom or anything. And I absolutely loved it. And I would have loved to stay for like a month or two more than what we could, because it's just, it's so amazing to be out there in the middle of nowhere.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's so true. And Casey, what are your conditions like when you go up? If you're doing a bit more summer work, what's that like where you are?
Yeah, so again, I think I've been spoiled here. Because we're up in summer, there's a lot of teachers that live in Pang during the school year, and then they're Southerners and they move back down south for the summer. So we generally rent a house from them. It is a little bit different from home. You have limited water. We ran out of water 1 year. The tank that was interesting for a few days, and obviously you can't stream Netflix all the time. That's hard when you're stuck in the house for a week on end if the weather's bad. I've been lucky. I will say we were supposed to sleep on the boat 1 year. It's a really, really small boat. It would have been cramped, but I actually was looking forward to that. I think it would have been fun. So maybe in the future.
Yeah. So that is a really good point about internet and streaming Netflix in the field, because I think that's something maybe a lot of folks don't realize. And we actually have a question from Louie about that. How do you get internet out there? Well, in a lot of places, there isn't internet, depending on some really remote northern field camps. We get very, very spoiled in Churchill. I'll also tell a spoiled story. So I have stayed at the Churchill Northern Study Center in Churchill, which is a fantastic research station and so much more than that. Check them out online if you have a moment. They do all sorts of different work. And when you stay there as a researcher, you have access to this like industrial kitchen. And if it's a busy time of year, they already maybe have a cook there and you get these great dorm rooms. So it's like luxury living. And now in Churchill, PBI also has Polar Bears International House. So we actually have a house there that we are able to work out of and base our field camp out of with all our gear and everything. And it is so incredibly impactful on all the work we do to actually have a home that we go to every year that's can be well maintained and has internet. And the team at Polar Bears International, along with the town of Churchill and other groups, including the Churchill Northern Study Center, have worked really hard to get solid internet to Churchill because it makes a world of difference. But a lot of places across the north still have limited access, even in places where there are communities and there are students. So I'll give you an example. We work with Connected North, who's a wonderful network of educators across Northern Canada, and we connect with all these classrooms across Nunavut. But in order for them to set up even a virtual connection like this, they have to email the Nunavut government to set aside time to ensure that they have the bandwidth to even get a half hour chat over the internet. They actually have to like reserve internet time because it's so limited there. And that is, you know, that's not a good thing. These people deserve better internet. So we're really hoping that, you know, Canada can push this forward and folks across the north have better access to these resources, because it's so critical. We're so connected these days and so much is online, and there really needs to be better options for the internet, not just for Arctic researchers, but for these other communities too that we visit. So that's my little talk on that, because I don't think people realize, again, in the north, it's so, so different up there. Okay, so we're going to go through a couple more questions. We have one question about some schooling that you needed to do. So I think a couple people have kind of talked about this already, but what kind of school? Maybe we'll do Cassandra on this. Like, what did you need to take in school to do what you do now?
So I took a lot of biology courses that focused on the study of living things in general. And then, of course, as I was able to move through in university, I was able to focus more on vertebrates. So those are all the animals that have a backbone. And then I got even more specialized into mammals and boreal animals specifically. And so now we're talking about some of the northern animals. For my master's research, because I was also looking at a way of how to develop new techniques and how this could improve ways that we do research polar bears, and how could this also, what this might mean for policy or management, I took a few courses that were interdisciplinary. So it wasn't just science focused, but also how do we incorporate other ways of knowing, and how do we bring other stakeholders to the table to make decisions to conserve not just polar bears, but all Arctic animals.
Thank you so much for that. We are going to take one more question and then we're going to maybe take a selfie. So stay tuned for that. But there's one question that came in that I wanted to answer quick. So it was, how can engineers help in Arctic research? So most of us are talking about kind of biology right now, but you're right, engineering is so critically important. And there is the person who's running the slide you might see right now, BJ Kirschhoff from PBI staff, has basically become the Polar Bears International Engineer. And what we are doing with polar bears would not be possible without engineering expertise. So I'll give you an example. We are currently working on a better way to track polar bears. So right now, or kind of the main way we used to track polar bears was with a collar, but we can only collar adult females. Males have necks that are too big and, you know, younger bears are still growing. So there's this whole section of polar bears that we couldn't track on the ice. We didn't know where they were moving or when. So we wanted to find a better way. How can we track polar bears in a way that doesn't bother them, but that we still learn information? And it's not as easy as it sounds. Well, we were able to partner with 3M, big engineering firm out of the States. And we've been working on, we call it the Burr on Fur Project, because we're looking at a way to attach a tracker just to polar bear fur. Like, you know, when you go for a walk in the woods and you get the little burrs stuck to you. Similar idea. How can we stick a tracker in their fur so it doesn't bug them and it just kind of sticks in there and eventually falls off? On your screen, hopefully you can see a few examples of what the 3M engineers came up with. These have currently, test ones have been deployed on polar bears in the Arctic, and we've had some great success so far, so it'll still be a little while until everything is finalized and they're rolled out, but the polar bear community is very excited about this. It opens up a lot of opportunities to less invasively track polar bears and learn so much about them. So that's one really great example of engineering making a massive difference in biology and ecology work. So we are going to continue answering your questions in just a moment, but we are going to pause for a second, and hopefully we can put up a really cute picture for you to look at for 30 seconds. We're hoping you can take a selfie together. So give you a minute. So get set up, take a selfie of yourself in your classrooms, and maybe even us in the background if you can figure out that. We would love you to tag at Polar Bears and at Flipgrid, and you can use the hashtag Flipgrid for all. And I'm going to repeat that in a moment. But please, if you can take 30 seconds, snap a photo, go ahead, send them in, post them on Twitter. Again, tag at Polar Bears, at Flipgrid, and hashtag Flipgrid for all. And yeah, send them to us. We definitely will have people that are going to take a look. So I'm going to give you a few more seconds to do that while you look at this very cute picture of a mom and cubs. And we can't wait to see your faces, because you've been looking at ours for almost half an hour already. Awesome. And you can see the moderator put there in the chat box as well, if you're more of a reader than an auditory learner like myself. So you can see there. Post your favorite moments from today's event on Twitter and tag us using hashtag Flipgrid for all, at Flipgrid, and at Polar Bears. And at Polar Bears is the Twitter handle for Polar Bears International. And I know our team would love to see you guys and let us know where you're from too. Give you a few more seconds and we'll keep on rolling. Fabulous. Okay, so I'm going to dive back into a couple questions, but please do send us your selfies, take a moment as you can, or listen in while you're finishing up here. I'm going to throw this one over to you, Casey. Does it ever become summer in the Arctic, or at least a little bit hot, or is it just always cold?
That's a good question. It depends. It definitely depends where you are in the Arctic. So I work in one of the most southern places that's still considered the Arctic Circle. And I'd say in July, it can get up to like 10 degrees Celsius, 50 Fahrenheit. That never happens when I'm there, of course. It's always colder. it's colder on the water too. But yeah, they do definitely have seasons. And another thing to keep in mind is the sun, right? So when we're up there in summer, it's light almost the entire day. There's about 3 hours of darkness when we're up there. So we have to put foil on the windows and everything to be able to sleep. But yeah, there are seasons. It does get warm.
And I think this is a good point to reiterate too. So especially where we work in Churchill, Manitoba, Polar Bears International does a lot of work. It's home to the Western Hudson Bay polar bear population there. These polar bears do come on shore in the summer. So Hudson Bay has what we call seasonal sea ice. And that means that in the winter season, there is sea ice across the whole bay and the bears are out there hunting seals. But in the summer, it does warm up enough so that that sea ice melts and polar bears come onto land for the summer. And that gives us a great opportunity to study them, to watch them, to live stream them on our polar bear cams if you check those out in the fall. And it's interesting because these bears, they have adapted to stay on land for months. They don't really eat when they're on land. They might just forage a bit for seaweed and eggs and that. There's no seals though, of course. But what's happening to these polar bears is that it is warming up in the Arctic. And that means that sea ice is breaking up earlier and it's freezing up later in general. And the bears are now spending approximately 3 or 4 weeks longer on land than they did a couple decades ago. And this has had impacts on their population. So the population has declined up to about 30% in the last few decades. The bears are smaller, they're having smaller cubs, fewer cubs. So we do know that climate change is impacting polar bears, especially in this region. Of course, the Arctic is a huge place. Things are happening at different rates in different ways, depending on where we look. But climate change is something that we are concerned about. And, you know, its root cause is that when humans burn fossil fuels like fuel oil and gas, like coal oil and gas, we release carbon emissions into the atmosphere. And these carbon emissions act like a heat trapping blanket. So they keep our Earth nice and warm, but we are now pumping too many carbon emissions into the atmosphere. We've released too much, we've burned too much fossil fuels, and now we've got too thick of a blanket. So we're simply trapping too much heat. It can't escape into space. It's getting trapped by these emissions. So sea ice really acts like our Earth's air conditioner in a lot of ways because it's so bright and reflective. It reflects heat away from the Earth and it helps cool down the entire planet. So when we lose sea ice, we're absorbing more of this warmth. And of course, polar bears and beluga whales and seals and all these creatures in the Arctic that rely on sea ice are impacted, but people are too, no matter where you live. So it's very important that we do work to protect the Arctic because protecting the Arctic means really protecting all of us and all the species that we love and care about and work toward, and all the people that live in the North, but also all around the world. So thank you for the questions on climate change and the warmth in the Arctic. Yes, it is very, very cold much of the year, but it absolutely gets warm and it's getting too warm right now. So Tia, I've got a couple just polar bear biology questions if you want to rattle them off real quick, rattle off some answers. So
sure.
We've got one from Tyler. Yeah. How far do polar bears dive in the water? How deep can they dive?
Let's see. I think it was in Norway, so in Svalbard, that the satellite collars that you were talking about earlier, they actually had depth sensors on those collars too. And they saw that bears could dive down to, I believe it was 13 meters. They wouldn't go that deep, you know, very often, but they could if they wanted to.
That's pretty deep. That's pretty good.
It is. I think some people, I know that there are photographers who've been in the water with bears, like photographing them from below, and they were so sure that the bears couldn't dive very deep. And well, I'm just happy that the bear didn't try, you know?
Yeah, no kidding. Wow. Another polar bear question for you. Do mother bears get aggressive if you get too close to their babies?
Oh, it doesn't matter if we're talking about polar bears or humans or dogs or mice or what have you. Moms will defend their offspring, and that goes for polar bears too. So definitely don't come between a mom and her cubs.
Great advice for anyone, anywhere with any bear. Agreed. So this is a hilarious question. I'm just going to answer this one and move on. I don't think we all need to answer it because I think I probably can speak for many of us. What do you do if you have to use the bathroom while you're in the field? And this is kind of a silly question, but it is seriously important because it is something we've all come across. When you're up in the Arctic, there's not a lot of trees, there's not a lot of hills to hide behind, and you're out in the field potentially 8 to 12 hours a day. What are you going to do? Well, everyone's just really polite about it, in my experience, especially if you're working with any guys. You know, the girls might go off together. Everyone just kind of looks away. You find a little place. I've definitely squatted behind a helicopter a couple times, and you just kind of like, as quick as you can, keep as warm as you can, and then you just get on with it. So hand sanitizer, good to go. you know, nature calls. So everyone figures it out in the field and everyone's had to do it. So it's kind of a funny part of field work. And usually on the lunch break, everyone also finds the little corner and doesn't look at each other. So there you go. Thank you for that question. And we've got an important question from, again, Mrs. Olson's class. So is it hard being a female scientist? And have you experienced any challenges because of your gender? And this is probably very different for a lot of different women, but I'll throw it out to you all. And maybe Cassandra, start with you on this one.
That's a great question. Typically, a lot of the science fields, and I think a lot of Arctic science, has been dominated by men. And so I think we're slowly starting to see more and more women become more involved in sciences and then also have a huge interest for the Arctic. A lot of my experience, because some of the field work that we do, I work with Fisheries and Oceans Canada, so there's a lot of hands-on working with the whales in the water or seals and also with bears. So there's been that typical, I guess, stigma that men, you need strong muscles, but women are just as strong, and we are starting to, a lot of our field programs have almost more women than men. And so the more questions that you ask if you're a woman and the more passion you have, you will be able to go into the field and you'll be able to, you're strong too. And I find that that was the biggest challenge for me, is kind of all women just breaking that barrier that we are strong and that we can go and do field work too. And I think having the passion to go for it is what is the most needed ingredient for us.
Thank you. How about you, Casey?
Yeah, I agreed with what Cassandra said. I think I'm unique. I've actually never been up to the field with a woman. My first year up, I was going up with four or five other men, only one of whom I'd met before. So that was a little intimidating. And you know, you live on the boat with them for 14 hours a day, and then you live in the house with them too. So yeah, that was intimidating. Also, kind of jumping back to the bathroom one, our floater suits that I mentioned, those onesies to keep us warm, the one that I was in was made for a man. They do make some for women, but they're much more expensive. So we didn't have any. So that's, I mean, little things like that that you wouldn't even think of. It's, and you know, the men that are coordinating the field work don't think about it. So yeah, little things like that can be tough.
Very interesting point there. Tia, how about you?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a complex question, right? But I absolutely agree with Casey. Like, most every piece of equipment that you will need to use in the field was made for a dude. Right, by a dude. So that's really something to keep in mind. But I mean, the polar bear research field is absolutely male dominated. I've seen more and more women come in, and you know, room is being created for more and more women. But we still have a problem with the leaky pipeline, it's called, where you will see that the higher you get in the ranks of research, the fewer women are still in the mix, right? So we still have a ways to go, at least in polar bear research, and I think in other fields too. But it is starting to change, and I, for one, would love to help in every way that I can, because I truly believe that not just research, but most anything in life is better if you have like a mix of people, a diverse mix of people, also when it comes to genders, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, thanks for that, T. I think those are some really good points. I guess I would say any young women and young men watching this today who are interested in a future in science, in the Arctic or not, I think it's really cool these days to see how much social networking and peer-to-peer support there is. I think this is something that has evolved really rapidly in the last decade or two. I think even when I started in this field about 10 years ago, there wasn't the kind of support that seems to be out there now. So I would say take advantage of that. Talk to, you know, your peers, but also find potential mentors in your field. If you're a young woman looking for a woman who's more experienced in the field, you know, reach out. I've had some just fantastic, supportive chats and discussions with all sorts of different people in the broad field of polar bear biology and Arctic ecology. And there's just some really great pages to take out of everyone's book. So definitely don't be afraid to approach people. I'd say generally, people are pretty nice and pretty supportive of young and up and coming scientists. And there's a lot of really great opportunities to just ask questions and just go get to know someone a little better and pick their brain about something you're interested in. And don't be afraid to ask those questions or find support whenever you need it. So like Tia said, we definitely need more women going farther in research, and it takes all different types and all different backgrounds to really tackle these problems effectively. So very great questions. I'd like to shift gears just for a quick minute here, because earlier I mentioned that, you know, art can be a really important part of science and science communication and just messaging people about what we love. And I think that that can be, at first when you say something like that, it's like, what, those are two different things. But really, I think in the science community, we're finding more and more how much we can really weave in different types of art and music into what we're doing. So I know Cassandra has a couple really great examples that she can speak to for a minute about art in the Arctic.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, Elisa, you mentioned it perfectly, that I think sometimes scientists, when we think about art, it's at first you're like, well, how does that work into science? And I remember my first bio lab, I had to draw specimens that I saw underneath the microscope. So there is a bit of art to science. You might, sure, it's a scientific drawing, but it's art. And when I go up north, I always try to look at some of the Inuit art. So I can't hold it too close to the camera, but for example, some of the Inuit art, they depict things that we study. And so in this photo, we see a bear catching a seal. And so this is a way for Inuit culture also to be put into an art form for us to use, also to inform some of our, what we know about the food web and learning more about the food web. And so again, weaving in different ways of knowing through art and through Inuit knowledge has been really helpful. Other things that I have that I can share is a lot of the art in the north is in the form of sculptures. And again, with my background, as soon as I hold it up in front of me, it kind of disappears. But here's a seal that I got from an Inuit artist in Nauyat in Nunavut. And when I went to Northwest Territories, depending on where you are in the Arctic, different animals seem to be the main ones that are getting sculpted. So again, in Northwest Territories, here is another seal made out of muskox bone, because there's a lot of muskox in Northwest Territories. Of course, those are a land animal, but those are some of the resources that they have in order to make sculptures. And then my favorite one that I have is when I did a narwhal survey, that one of the Inuit guides that we were working with showed me somebody who could make and sculpt out a little narwhal. So this is one of the ways that I try to like continually think about how art influences science and my connection to the north.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Cassandra, for sharing those. Yeah, I think it's so important. If we want people to care about a species or about something, we really need them to feel that connection and understand it. And I think science is a part of that, but art is so much a part of that, especially from the people that are living in the Arctic and seeing these animals and carving something. And it's such an inspiration to see that. And there's so much fantastic art out there, in sculpture, in painting, also in music and poetry. I do believe we have at least one, if not more, Flipgrid activities about the art of polar bears in the Arctic. So please do check out the Polar Bears International Flipgrid activities and see if there's something in there that you can maybe do with your class or at home with your family. There's some really neat opportunities there to find out how art can help us understand and appreciate even more. And it really can go hand in hand with science so, so well. So we're going to take a couple more questions and then we're going to start wrapping up. And once again, if you haven't sent your selfie in yet, we really would love to see you guys. So again, those hashtags, well, the hashtag is hashtag Flipgrid for all. And you can tag at polar bears and at Flipgrid. So we would really love to see that. Thank you so much. And I'll just take a couple more questions here. Casey, one for you. How big are the whales that you might have seen? Like, are these really big whales we're talking about?
Belugas aren't that big compared to other whales. I mean, they're a lot bigger than us. But mostly actually what I'm doing with my fieldwork is tagging and photographing bowhead whales, which are a lot bigger. And actually those bowhead whales live to be over 200 years old, which I think is really cool. Yeah, you can see one in the photo there. So we're taking a biopsy. But yeah, belugas are one of the smaller whales.
I bet they still feel pretty big when they're next to your boat. That's so cool. And I another quick shout out, if you guys are interested in beluga whales, starting in July, there is a live beluga whale cam in Church of Manitoba that Polar Bears International helps run with explore.org. So you can see live beluga whales and also take part in a citizen science project that's called Beluga Bit. So if you log in at that time in the summer, you can check that out and actually be a citizen scientist yourself and help us catalog the beluga whales as well in Churchill. So whales are so, so cool. Love them. Oh, I see moms and babies there. And you can also hear them on the cam, which is very just beautiful to hear. So this is also kind of a fun question. And I like these ones because it's like, what on earth are you guys doing up there? What are you eating when you're in the Arctic? How do you eat when you're in the field? I know for me, every day when we go out in the helicopter every day looking for polar bears, peanut butter sandwiches were a big one because they're really easy to make. They last forever, a lot of calories. Chocolate bars are good. Always take something warm and a really good thermos in case you're stuck somewhere. You just need to warm up. And then some extra water and just a lot of high calorie snacks. So your body's using up a lot of energy trying to stay warm. And you always need to be prepared if a snowstorm rolls in really, really quick and your helicopter can't lift off or something else happens, you want to have food on you at all times. So that is something that we always do. I don't know if any of you have anything else to add. Maybe any like special treats in the field, Cassandra?
When I was in Svalbard, I got hooked on, there's dehydrated meals that you can have when you go camping and you just add really hot water, but there was a particular brand that we had when we were in Svalbard that I can't remember what it's called, but it was an orange package and you can't get them here. And I'm so sad because they were actually really good dehydrated meals. Of course, I've had some here. Again, like Elisa said, you have to have a really good thermos to keep that water boiling hot. And taking a lot of those. And I'm always a snacker. So I have a pocket full of M&Ms or a pocket full of raisins at all times when I'm anywhere, but particularly when I'm in the field, always snacking.
Nice. I know a lot of our pilots and researchers always have a pocket full of jerky too. So that's also a big one in the field. So a question from Mrs. Kim's class, have you experienced a snowstorm while working in the Arctic? And maybe Tia, I'll ask you.
Several times. We haven't gotten buried or anything like that, but yeah, like weather can change really quickly in the Arctic. And one of the weathers that you really want to look out for, especially if you're doing helicopter-based work, is a snowstorm. Because that may actually, if you haven't made it back to your cabin, that means that you have to sit down on the ice or on the ground. And if you're there, you may not be able to see a polar bear coming by to investigate you in the middle of the snowstorm because they may not necessarily care. So you really don't want to be out there. And so you keep an eye on the weather at all times. If you're inside the cabin or, the field station, it's a beautiful sight.
Quite cozy. And this is another good area where technology and engineering and other types of science really come into play here. So that is something we're doing every single day working up north. Even in the summer, you're looking at the weather and you're looking at weather charts. You're going online to like the government website, looking at future weather predictions from the actual chart. You're not just, looking at the kind of daily news sort of thing. You're looking at what's coming in, your pilot's looking at what's coming in, you're constantly assessing and you always have an exit plan. So if something starts rolling in really fast, like a snowstorm, you can get out of there very quickly because it can be dangerous. So it does happen, but generally the great technology these days does allow for a little bit more predictability and better planning of what we're going to do. So just a couple more questions and then we will sign off and say goodbye. We have one question here. T, I'm going to throw this one to you. Mm-hmm. It's about polar bears. Do you name the polar bears and do you have a favorite?
Nice. I think every polar bear I've ever met has been my favorite, they're amazing. We do not actually name them per se, so they don't have a name like everyone watching and myself, but we give them individual numbers. So yeah, they kind of have a name, but it's like X33953, right? Which is not really a name like you usually think about it, but they do have individual names or numbers, sorry. Yeah, and those numbers, those individual numbers, they're tattooed on the inside of the lip of the bear, and they're also etched into this tiny little ear tag that is put into to the ear of the bear, so that if we ever do recapture a bear, we will know who it is, right? Just by their individual number.
Very important. Yep, thank you for that answer. I think that's something a lot of people are curious about. Okay, so last question and then we're wrapping up. So again, thank you to everyone who joined us. I just really would love each panelist to briefly say, what is your favorite part about what you do? And let's start with Casey.
Oh, that's so tough. I'll say field work in general is the best part of my job. And yeah, just being in the community and you know, experiencing a different way of life to what you're used to is really cool. I think that's true of, you know, anytime you travel. But specifically in the Arctic, obviously I'm partial to marine mammals. So, you know, seeing these species in the Arctic, I love, you know, polar bears and belugas. Even, you know, when we're motoring out, we can hear the belugas above the water. We can hear them from the boat vocalizing. They're extremely vocal species. So that's always my favorite part of the day when I'm up there.
Love that. Thank you. Tia, how about you? What's your favorite part of what you do?
Well, there are many favorite parts, but I mean, absolutely, I agree with Casey. Field work is one of them. But also, I really enjoy the creative process of doing research, you know, creativity and the way that you have to connect with people. You have to try and imagine how your different strengths can come together to create something that's bigger. You have to try and imagine new solutions to old problems, all of these things. I really enjoy that. And of course, I mean, it's such a privilege to be able to, you know, have a job where if there's something I like, a question, a scientific question that I really want to get answered, or at least try to, I can do that, right? Like, I always have a lot of questions, and I am in the exact line of work that allows me to try and find the answers. How amazing is that?
I love that. There's a really nice bit of, yeah, power and creativity there, like you said. That it's a very neat part of the job. And Cassandra, do you have a favorite part of your job?
Well, I definitely agree with everything that's been said, and it's such a tough question because there's some days that what you enjoy most might change, but the field work is great and getting connected to the community and getting connected to the animals that you're studying, seeing them with your own eyes definitely is very impactful. But what I really love most is similar to what Tia said, is that I love that my work's never done. Whenever you find the answer to a question, there's usually 10 more that you have discovered or asked. And being working with a team and considering different ways of knowing, and as Tia mentioned also, like bringing in a diversity of voices, so community members, or a broad team, engineers, artists, scientists, and even you yourselves as students watching this, the more that you ask, the more that we can answer, but then the more questions we have and the more we can all learn. And so my favorite part of this job is actually talking to as many people and students like yourselves each day. And that gives me the most motivation to continue doing what I'm doing, and I just love it.
Thanks, Cassandra. And I'll build on that. That is absolutely one of my favorite parts of my job now, is getting to talk to people about what we do, bring different panelists and different people together to spread their knowledge and their help and their support. And thank you so much to our panelists here today for answering all these questions and for sharing some of your knowledge and experiences. And thank you so, so much to the viewers tuning in today. Thank you for your questions. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your selfies. Please do post those. We would love to see them. Thank you so much for tuning in to this Flipgrid event. There's a new Flipgrid event every Wednesday at the same time. And please do check out the Polar Bears International Flipgrid activities. We've got a whole variety of things on there, and we will be adding new ones all the time. There will be some new math ones coming up this spring, which is exciting. So thank you again to the Microsoft team, to our team, to all of you. If you have any more questions, I believe our moderators will still try to answer what we can, and we will hopefully see you again in the future sometime. So thank you again. Have a great rest of your day, and we'll see you soon.